I hate people who watch anime. They're my least favorite human beings.
Rude. Earth.
Corey, you hate me, I hate you. That's how this podcast thrives.
That's fair.
And we love each other. It's real. It causes real tension.
Sweet Christmas.
Hello. This is Che.
This is Corey.
And this is the Next Time On Podcast, a podcast where two lifelong friends discuss all things amazing and all things feted in popular culture. Today, we will, of course, be discussing the March Madness Men's Wrestling Tournament. Corey, yes. Who do you think is going to win the March Madness Men's Wrestling Tournament? Give me 1 second.
Who's going to win? Gay men everywhere.
What a way to start the podcast.
This is the hot takes episode, I think. This is just a lot of spice in this episode.
I will say, I'm not like a wrestling guy, but I got a lot of friends who are big into wrestling.
I didn't even know it was like...
about that.
I didn't know it was going to be at the same time. Whoa, listen. I didn't say other people couldn't enjoy it. I'm just saying a specific group of individuals would enjoy it.
No, yeah, I think they do all of the March Madnesses at once. I say this as somebody who has basically never watched a college game of any sort in any sport at any time in my life.
Do you think though? Like, do you think like people think March Madness, men and women's basketball? Mm-hmm. Do you think like it's also March Madness? Like, it's really not. Like, it's like you guys are doing shit, but it's like it's in March, but no one really gives a shit.
I mean, as evidenced by the fact that I have Googled the words March Madness Men's Wrestling Tournament Bracket, which is a little bit probably on me, because they probably don't call the wrestling one March Madness, and all of the results are the basketball tournament.
You can get a lot of weird stuff in your emails coming up.
It's okay. I don't read my email anyway. Which brings me to our points of business. Don't email us. Don't worry about that. You don't have to email
you
us.
You can email us at nextsomeonpod@gmail.com.
I mean, you can, but don't.
I check it.
Contact us if you want to at nexttimeonpod on all your social media platforms, including over there. Most importantly, on the YouTube, youtube.com/@nexttimeonpod, where you can see all of this good stuff in live Technicolor. Not live. I don't know why I said live, but it's in video form.
It's and like if one you're day, over we, there on YouTube. We would do streaming once, but then you have to cut out all of my disastrous bits that I do.
What would we stream though? We've talked about it before. We even like floated playing the like Batman Telltale game.
I think that's pretty much the only thing we could do. I think that's what we would have to do. But the thing about it is there hasn't really been a good comic book video game in a while. Looking at you, Suicide Squad.
Well, the thing that I wanted to do, not that we have the viewer base or the listener base for it, but I really wanted to do, bringing this up in the week that it was announced that it's disappearing, is Twitch had this, or has currently, for a few more days, this thing where you can do watch parties live with anything on Amazon Prime legally. Because there are plenty of people who watch shit illegally on Twitch, but legally you can do a watch party. And I think it'd be really fun to just find, I don't think people realize this, the Amazon Prime movie library is very deep and it's full of trash, like real garbage film. And it would be really fun to just watch
I'd love to do a Mystery Science Theater type thing of Amazon shit movies, honestly.
Well, we talked about for a while doing, it's not a shit movie, I love it, it's the greatest movie of all time, but we talked about for a while doing a Babylon episode where I could never really figure out the angle where like I try to explain Babylon to you or maybe we watch Babylon or something. But then today, literally today, dropped in my feed of the Big Picture did a Babylon watch along. So they really jack in my stees, which I'm not a big fan of.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah, it's all right.
It reminds me of my...
Ladies and gentlemen watching the YouTube video will see my video flip because I forgot to flip it, but it's now officially flipped. It's been kind of just 2 years of my background being reversed, but I did it.
This is not going to be in our subject matter of what it is, but it's still one of my favorite things of media that I've been consuming recently. And I don't like to plug another podcast. Mm-hmm. But I've been listening to Till Death Do Us Blart, and I think it might be one of my favorite social experiments I've ever...
What
ever.
Could that be? Is it about Paul Blart Mall Cop?
Yes, Paul Blart Mall Cop 2. So it is, can I remember the name of the New Zealand dudes, but it's the people from My Brother and Me. Okay.
Okay.
And these two guys from The Worst Idea in the World, I think, the name of their podcast.
Which is where they watched, like, what was the movie they watched over and over again?
Sex in the City,
The
Cats.
Second one, right?
Yes, the second one. And Grown Ups 2 was the first one.
Having so, never watched the first.
Yes. And so that's what they did with Paul Blart 2. But they basically watch it once a year every Thanksgiving. They've been doing it since 2015.
Fucking Guy Montgomery's on this?
Yes.
I love Guy Montgomery. I'm going to watch this for sure.
It's fucking amazing. It's like, it's really good because you're seeing like each year is just like a descent in the madness of a group of individuals.
Oh, of course.
And the mission statement of it is like, they're going to do it until they all die. So this is just a continuous thing of like for the rest of time, apparently. And they like have like named people to bequeath it to once they do pass away. But I think, like, I recommend it.
This curse that they've enacted upon themselves.
I think around, like, episode 3 or 4, it's just, like, you kind of just see the breaking of, like, what happened, what you have to do to see this movie every year and then have to think about, like, new things to talk about.
Yeah, I haven't listened to any of it. I've heard about the podcast. I think you've talked about it before. I am morbidly curious about the idea of watching. Because I think people have heard me talk about how I'm not a big rewatcher of stuff if I don't, like, not to, like, tens and dozens of times. There are people who watch like the same movie all the time.
I think for me it's mostly just like fun action movies or like, but never like, it's hard for me to be like a straight up like a arty like thought-provoking film. I don't really do that every year. I mean, like, I'm not even doing this as a bit. I probably watch Speed Racer like once every 2 years. Not even doing it as a bit. I just think it's a very fun movie.
Yeah.
I but like doing the same bad movie. Like, imagine if like making us watch The Santa Claus every year. I think we might kill each other.
Well, I did it twice for the podcast.
I did it twice too. And I had a really bad time.
It's awful. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm fascinated. Now that I know Guy Montgomery, who is one of my favorite,
I really recommend. I didn't
since ever. Is on that.
Wait, he was on Taskmaster?
On the
New Zealand one? Or Australian. They're from New Zealand. They keep talking about New Zealand. That's the only reason I know about it. But
there
maybe
is a New Zealand and it is an Australian one. And I don't remember which one he's on because there's also people who are both New Zealand and Australian on the counter. Like they
let's be real. British people, Australian people, and New Zealand people, you're all the fucking same to me.
I didn't say that. Listen, if you're listening to the podcast in audio format, that was Corey Bishop who said
that. Yeah, call me out.
So when the fucking Australians come to your door with their kangaroo clubs and yo-yos,
they can't get off.
You,
they can't get off their island. What are they going to do?
A bunch of fucking communists.
What are they going to do?
Well, we've already started the theme of this episode, which is for those of you who are regular listeners, will know every episode, well, not every episode, most episodes, we do a little elevator pitch, and for just a thing we love. And today we're gonna do a whole episode of that. Each of us picked 5 things that we love, either recent or not, or just stuff we've been enjoying. And we'll
just want to talk about
for a few minutes each. Go down the line. Before we jump into that, though, a reminder, next episode, if you're reading along, is going to be Damn Them All by Simon Spurrier, the gothic horror action fantasy comedy comic book. Very good. 13 issues. We're doing all 13. And we'll be doing that, like I said, next episode. So that'll be hitting your feeds soon. So don't forget to subscribe for that. Corey, do you have a movie to announce? I know I asked you this before, but I don't remember.
I do not.
We'll get you guys one. No worries.
Yeah, coming to the month of April. Oh man, I don't even know what the fuck's going on in April. Nothing right now.
Should we do a shitty Godzilla movie?
I was literally thinking, should we do the Matthew Broderick Godzilla movie? That actually might not be a bad one.
Is that gonna be fun?
I think it might be.
Is it shitty enough to be enjoyable versus like?
That's the question that we always encounter, Che.
I know.
Had that
Let's,
fire.
We'll call commercial. It now. Let's, we're gonna do. It, we're gonna do the okay. Matthew Broderick.
I do remember it had that really good. Even as a kid, I remember how good that commercial was. It was like, I think it was like the shaking water commercial. Mm-hmm. Really good commercial, and also Cloverfield is probably the better Godzilla movie from that era. But yeah. I digress.
Yes.
I don't ever want to do Cloverfield. I actually do like Cloverfield, the movie, but
it's been a long time since I've seen the first Cloverfield. I loved 10 Cloverfield Lane. I remember
10 Cloverfield Lane is probably the best one. Cloverfield Paradox does not belong in the same breath.
Well, it's also, it's not, it's so funny. Realizing it after the fact, after the stories came out about what that movie actually was, it was never a Cloverfield movie in any stretch of the way, like, at all. It was just some garbage that Netflix had, like, on a hard drive somewhere.
And then they edited it around.
They didn't even really bother to edit it, because I don't think anybody says the word Cloverfield.
They had the monster in the very end of it.
Yeah,
in
the very end. That's right.
It's like someone just, like, goes, like, hold on. This movie's shit, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's just add the Cloverfield monster to it and be like, yeah, people, listen, I watched it that night. Like, yeah. I remember after Super Bowl, I was fucking excited as
shit. Genius marketing idea, terrible film. I mean, to be fair,
that's
the
Cloverfield
paradox. That is kind of how 10 Cloverfield Lane goes too, though. It doesn't really have any relation to the movie. And then as he's driving away in the end, you see the monster in the clouds.
Yeah, no, it's like it nothing to do with it. But the Cloverfield franchise might be the best film marketing kind of campaign I've ever seen, because I think people talk more about the marketing of those films than the actual films themselves.
Yeah.
But it is a shame. I think I've seen the director from 10 Cloverfield Lane really do much else since then. I think I was looking them up like around the time, because I think they announced to make another Cloverfield movie, but I mean, who fucking actually knows if that's true or not?
Well, he did Prey, which we liked.
He did Prey. That's right. I liked Prey a lot. Okay, I was wondering what happened to him, and I'd be okay if he made like another Prey Predator type movie. So I mean, at least they're doing something different. Like, unlike the new Alien film, which looks just like the old Alien film.
It's fascinating to me that Ridley Scott, who is deep into his 80s, has chosen to spend the final few films that he has in his career, however many we get, I hope it's many, many more, but let's be realistic, it's probably not going to be a ton more as he approaches the age of 90. It's just fascinating. This is what he's chosen to do. He's chosen to continue to make alien movies. Very, very weird Napoleon biopic. I don't know if you've ever, have you watched Napoleon yet?
No, I mean, everyone kind of just talked me off of doing it, honestly.
I had this realization the other day that I texted a friend who had also seen Napoleon. He was really excited for the movie and was
quite, I was excited for it too. It.
Yeah, he saw it and was quite disappointed by it. And I texted him and I had this realization myself, and I asked him if the movie had been called holy shit, I'm blanking on her name. Josephine de Bonaparte. If the movie had just been called Josephine instead of Napoleon, and it was the exact same movie, I asked him, would you have liked it more? And he said, yeah, I think I would have. Which is, I think, all you need to know about Napoleon. It's a very weird decision to make this movie named about Napoleon, starring Oscar winner Joaquin Phoenix, coming off of a pretty big, you know, resurgence in his career. And then making this movie where Napoleon is, I mean, for lack of a better word, like a weird cuck. It's just a strange decision.
And I just want to point out, though, that well, Ridley Scott's only producing the next Alien film, but he's not directing it. It's Fede Alvarez. I think he did Evil Dead and Don't Breathe. But I after watching the trailer, I'm like, we're just remaking Alien again. Like, at least, like, Prometheus is not a good movie.
I genuinely stand by Prometheus. I think Prometheus is actually,
I think Prometheus looks cool as shit. I think Prometheus has a lot of good ideas in it, but a lot of bad ideas in it as well. And it's just, I don't know, it's like, it's, and also they made that an Alien film as well. And I'm like, why do we do that? Like, we could have just made the whole Prometheus thing like that. They're on a strange alien planet, deal with bullshit, but then you have to include alien shit in it. We didn't have to include alien shit in it. We could have just, I don't know, left it the fuck alone.
Last thing before we jump into our episode, because
no, I'm okay. I like this. I like doing this.
On the spot, putting you on the spot again. I think we have actually talked about this before, but I don't remember what we landed on. Which franchise, considering all entries into both franchises, would you say is more successful? Not which one you prefer, but is more artistically successful. Alien or Terminator?
Artistically successful
as an entirety of franchise. I think it's inarguable at this point there is more bad Alien movies than good Alien movies, and that's more true. Bad Terminator movies than good Terminator movies.
That
but
is true.
They both also have true classic films in.
That's what I'm saying. Okay, so I think the thing about both of those franchises, the first two movies from both those franchises are really fucking good films,
right?
And then the rest are bad. And comparatively to that, Prometheus is probably the best of those movies besides all of those.
And I besides think, the first two, you mean? Prometheus is the best non-original two?
Best non-original
two. I think that's probably not even a
question. And in the pool of that, and I think, I mean, I have issues with Prometheus, but I still will think Prometheus looks really, really cool. Yeah. And I really like a lot of like the vibes of the sci-fi-ness of it. And I have a lot of issues with it. And Michael Fassbender is just fantastic in it.
Yeah, he's great.
So I think Alien. But I don't think it's like, it's not a wide margin. It's just they had one better film than all this shit that turned. Because Terminator put out a bunch of like really bad films, and so did Alien.
It's true. For me, I think it's a question of your opinion on what is more successful. Because I think, at least in my opinion, Terminator has higher highs. I think the best of all these movies is Terminator 2. I think it's the best of
all
the movies.
Agreed.
But I think also the worst of the movies is probably, I honestly don't even know which is the worst of the Terminator movies, but probably the bottom three are the most recent three Terminator movies. They're all so fucking bad.
I mean, oh man, what the fuck? I've seen all of the Terminators.
Yeah.
And I think I've seen the last.
I could not finish Dark Fate. I did not finish that movie.
I remember liking Dark Fate more than Genesis, but at the same time, I also was in a theater, so I had no choice but to like just stay there because I don't like leave it. I don't like leaving movies.
Yeah, yeah. I think I was on my couch about like, I think this was in, because I didn't see it in theaters. This was like deep into the pandemic of 2020. I was watching Terminator.
And you know what?
And there was a point I just went, nah, fuck this, and turned it off.
And you know what though? Salvation wasn't that bad. It wasn't good, but it wasn't like that.
Is Salvation
that
the
bad.
One with
Christian Bale? And
oh, that's not the one with
Jai Courtney.
Yeah.
No, it's not. That's the one. Jai Courtney one is with Emilia Clarke, and that one's just
That was the first moment I had this realization. I was like, oh no.
Yeah. So no, that was
Clarke not gonna have a successful career.
Well, I think, like, the problem is, like, if my agent was like, hey, I'm going to put you opposite of Jack Courtney, I'm like, oh, no, what are we doing right now?
He must be an incredible hang. He must be so fun.
He's like
nice.
I don't know. Seems like a nice guy.
Because he can't fucking act to save his life.
It's just, like, I don't think it's really his fault, but he always kept on, like, they kept putting him in these, like, the reboots of things as, like, the new character. He looks nothing like Kyle Reese.
Can I quickly just?
He looks nothing like him.
No, it's that he.
It's like not even the same dude.
He's fucking Australian.
Not even the same guy.
Can I quickly just read you what Jai Courtney's been up to in recent years?
Yeah, go ahead.
His most recent IMDb credits are as follows: the narrator of a series called For the Love of Pets.
Mm-hmm.
In a film called Catching Dust. He was also in the short-lived Netflix phenomenon Kaleidoscope. Terminal List as a billionaire villain. Voice actor in Love, Death, and Robots. A film called Blacksite, which has a whopping 4.4 on IMDb.
Wait, hold on. We had a movie called Blacksite? Like, what's that? What the fuck is
that
even about?
I've literally never heard of it. It also stars...
Is it about torture? What the fuck is it about?
I think it is. It stars Jason Clarke and Michelle Monaghan, and he's...
Jason Clarke looks like somebody who would do torture in a film.
the poster is just them... looking kind of beat up with an American flag behind them, so we know that movie's trash.
So that's a good thing? I'm so confused by what the hell that's about.
He's also in, of course, briefly in The Suicide Squad, Jolt, Honest Thief, which is a Liam Neeson movie. A late-stage Liam Neeson movie. He was in 6 episodes of the show Stateless, which I will report back.
What are these? You're just
these horrendous.
You're just making up things now. None of these sound like real projects.
I'm trying to get to my favorite part, though. So we have a voice in a movie called 100% Wolf I've never heard of. He was also in Semper Fi. Again, this guy is Australian, by the way.
Why is he doing so many American ones?
He's in a 2019 film called Buffaloed. I've never heard of or seen. And then this is my favorite, I think the peak of his career, uncredited in the film Alita: Battle Angel.
Woof.
So
woof.
That's what Jack Courtney's been up to.
Is his best role Captain Boomerang?
Is his best role Captain Boomerang? I mean, what else are we picking from? I guess.
I don't know. I'm just asking you.
I mean, I suppose so.
I don't know. Was he in Spartacus? Was he Spartacus? The second Spartacus?
Like the TV show?
Yeah.
I don't think so. I never watched the TV show, though, to be honest. Actually, you know what? His best role is in the very, very strange erotic Nazi thriller.
Okay.
from 2016 called The Exception, which is a trash film. And I went into it thinking it was going to be a war movie because it's set in Nazi Germany. And about 30 minutes in, it's just Jai Courtney and Lily James fucking. And that's the whole movie. Also, rest in peace to the legend. Christopher Plummer's in that movie as well. It's such a weird fucking movie. If you guys haven't seen The Exception,
I feel like Jai Courtney is who you pick when you want Tom Hardy to be in something.
Yeah, actually that is a good point. He's very much Australian Tom Hardy.
But just not. Let's not keep dunking on Jai Courtney. He's done nothing.
Let's be very clear. Jai Courtney's doing way better than we are. He does not care about this podcast. He is not listening. He's fine. But let's go to our top five.
I can't stop thinking about Nazi sex thing.
Every once in a while, I'll think about that movie because I think I watched it with a friend. I don't remember why we picked that movie. Or if she picked it and I picked it. But either way, we're just sitting there expecting a war movie. And then there's a scene that I vividly remember in my memory when he walks into her cabin and they're just having like a seemingly pretty regular conversation. And then suddenly she's naked. And I think we both looked at each other on the couch like, wait, what's going on in this film? What's this movie about? And then from that point on, the movie gets... progressively stranger.
This movie sounds like have you ever watched Documentary Now?
No, but I'm aware of what
there's this episode where like it's Bill Hader's playing this producer who's never won an Oscar. I don't actually remember what it's parodying, but it's like him just like buying and making all these really shit movies and just trying to capitalize on things. Mm-hmm. And someone probably was like, hey, we should make like a romantic war film set in like World War II. Got it, Nazis. Who am I rooting for here?
Well, that's the thing. I think I don't really remember the plot of this movie because, again, it's mostly just Lily James and Jai Courtney fucking for like about 90 minutes. But I think he's like my favorite film cliche. I think Jai Courtney is like a good Nazi. he's one of the good Nazis.
Yeah. Uh-huh, okay. sure. Uh huh.
All right, it's apparently on Max right now. You guys can go check it out if you have Max.
Fuck off. They have to go watch Godzilla.
Yeah, they can watch Exception after Godzilla. What a twofer. All right, Corey, do you want to go first?
Sure. Let me just go double check to see what I have it on my list.
We're gonna try, despite the fact that we were starting this episode about 20 minutes in, we're gonna try to do about 5 minutes between these topics, and we'll just talk. If it's a little bit less or a little bit more, so be it. But that's the idea, is we're just gonna try to pitch. Is pitch even the right word?
We're just talking about stuff that we want to talk about. Yeah. It's like one of those things. Like, I mean, the reason that we're doing this right now is that like, we are thankfully about to approach the summer movie season, mm-hmm. but it's been a bit of a dead period. And we talk about media, and sometimes media doesn't do anything that comes out. So we kind of wanted to do this kind of as like a way to reflect and talk about things that we are doing and kind of going in. And like,
I don't know if it's successful. Maybe we'll like do this like once every month or once every other month or something. I don't know.
But like, kind of in my quest to educate myself on film more, I've been trying to go back and watch films. And the first thing I'm talking about is a 1995 romantic film, Before Sunrise, starred Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy. I never really knew about this trilogy or like the series at all. Girlfriend mentioned that she wanted to watch at some point. So I was like, it's been on my radar for a while. I've been kind of waiting to get around and watching it. And I didn't really you know what I realized watching this film is that I don't think I've seen enough good romantic films. Because I feel like most romantic films in my brain are either like bad rom-coms or like cheesy schlock. And it's been so long since I watched a movie where I'm just like, want these two characters to just work out. If you guys haven't seen the movie, it's this American guy is in Europe and he runs into this French girl on a train. And after a brief conversation, he kind of convinces her to get off the train with him and hang out in Vienna for a night. And it's basically just kind of watching two people go on like a very long date. And just be very charismatic and a joy to be around. There's really not much of like a plot to it. there's not like any kind of manufactured drama besides the situation that they find themselves in.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I just kind of like, I was watching and I'm like, first of all, maybe we want to go to Vienna. It just was a very nice time just to walk around Europe with these two people. But I don't know. I just kind of feel like I left that with such a smile on my face that I was just like enjoying it so wholeheartedly.
Yeah. You said there's not really like a plot or drama. And I think that's in a lot of ways. We've talked about him before. That's really like the Richard Linklater experience.
I mean, yeah, we talked about Dazed and Confused, like at least briefly a long time ago. I saw it for the first time last summer.
And he has this this fascination, and not all of his movies, because actually we were talking about before this, he's a very prolific filmmaker and makes a lot of really diverse films. But for the ones that have certainly stood the test of time, he has this fascination with reflecting real life and things that are true to life. And I mean, I think sometimes that's really effective. Like, I love the Before trilogy, and it's like this exploration of this couple that you see over three decades, basically.
Yeah. And I mean, that's a really, I have not gone through the Before trilogy. I'm sure I'll check back in once I get the other two films in. But yeah, I've only seen the first one. And it is like kind of like interesting to learn. I don't actually know what the next two are about. But it's interesting to know, being like seeing the ending of the film. And I don't really want to spoil it, because I think people should really give this one a watch if they haven't. But it's just being like, that's the ending. And I'm like, okay, so the next one takes place 10 years later. And you're just like, oh, okay, the next one takes place 10 years later.
Yeah. And then 10 years after that again, yeah.
Yeah.
And I think the things that he does in the Before trilogy that I find really successful, he has become this sort of fascination with him in later life in a lot of his films, and then reached ahead in a lot of ways in Boyhood, which I've spoken about before on this podcast. I don't think is like a good movie. It's a very fascinating experiment. But as far as like watching this thing, I don't think it works. But it's one of those things that's like pretty hard to land that. You had to pick this kid out when he was literally a kid and then hope he grows up into a really competent actor. And I think there's a it's not really a surprise we haven't heard from Alar Coltrane again after the Boyhood dropped on our scene in 2014. But I'm with you that I think the Before trilogy is probably my favorite of Richard Linklater's movies. I'm fascinated to see what this Hitman movie looks like, which feels, again, so different from anything he's made before.
I was talking about a movie, going to talk a little bit, but I was watching Ghostbusters yesterday in the theater, and I saw that his name was on it. I'm like, I remember you mentioning it out loud, but like right after seeing the Before movies, it was very strange just to see like that out there. I'm having a very serendipitous week when I'm seeing two Richard Linklater things in theaters. I also had two Taskmaster cameos from the same season in different pieces of media that I watched.
From the same season.
Phil Wang.
Also in Ghostbusters?
No, he's in a three-body problem. Also, he was in Wonka as well. Not as, like, actual parts. I'm just like, oh, it's Phil Wang. And then,
Good for Phil.
That's how I saw him. I'm like, I'm thinking about that. I'm like, hey, good for Phil, man. Do your thing, buddy. Get your bag.
Yeah. No, I'm a big fan of Before Sunrise and the Before Trilogy generally. I think I agree with Corey. If you haven't seen them, you should absolutely go check those out. Anything else about the Before Sunrise? No.
I think I want to like probably talk about the. I'll probably bring up the when I watch the next two at some point. But it's just that was a really pleasant film. I had a really just nice time.
I think your point about like there are not many non-comedy romantic movies anymore that are very good. I find that they're usually pretty like either schlocky, like really cheesy garbage, or are dark in a lot of ways. Like All of Us Strangers, a movie that we both loved, you could really describe as a romantic movie, but dark in its core.
I saw like a listicle, I think it was like IndieWire, it was like top 25 romantic movies of like the 21st century, and that was on it, and I'm like, it's okay. Yeah. Like, I understand why you said it, but I'm also like,
I think there's a real cynicism in Hollywood around love and sex generally that I'm fascinated by, but a little saddened by as well. Like you don't see sex in movies anymore in a way that it's like fun and enjoyable, despite the fact that many sexual encounters between people in real life is not traumatizing, but all sex in film and TV is traumatizing or strange or really unhinged. But for example, even like stories about love are like Past Lives. We loved Past Lives. Past Lives is a movie about love, but also about like devastating heartbreak.
Yeah,
it doesn't seem like people can make movies that are just about how like people can love each other and be happy anymore.
That's what I think that's what took me by so much surprise. I was waiting for something to happen. Yeah. And I think they have a quick conversation without much spoilers being like, it's like, do you have a boyfriend or a girlfriend? I'm like, oh shit, this is about to be some and I'm like, oh no, it's just people just having conversations. This is just what it is. It's just kind of.
Yeah.
This is
I'm blanking on one, but I really genuinely cannot think of a movie from the last 5, maybe even 10 years about just like two people falling in love
just
with each other.
Just liking each other.
Yeah. And there's a lot of romantic movies bouncing around in my head. Like,
but that's like,
movies without, like Call Me By Your Name, I love, but it's also like, again, ends with Timothée Chalamet crying in an unbroken shot into a fireplace. Not a movie about two people happily falling in love.
Saltburn.
Fuck off. My turn. You piece of shit. I mean, honestly, Saltburn is a perfect example about a movie where, I'm going to spoil this movie, I don't care, you should never have watched it anyway, where every fucking person in the movie dies. It's like, we can't have anything nice anymore, I guess.
I think there's a level of sincerity that people just, I think cynicism and sincerity are just kind of like people just, I don't know, lost the plot a bit like that. You know, it's like, it's nice every once in a while remind yourself that the world just isn't shit.
Yeah. Agreed.
Yeah.
Okay, the thing I'm pitching, not really on purpose, I don't think either of us ordered these in any particular way, but I think the thing I'm pitching couldn't be more different, and that is a global phenomenon that I am very much catching up on. And I would say I'm not even really necessarily pitching this show in a vacuum. The thing that I'm pitching is The Traitors, more specifically The Traitors UK, which is a British reality television show that is one of the many different international versions of the Dutch original. I'm gonna fuck this up. De Verdaars.
I'm telling all of our Dutch listeners about that.
I think probably just means The Traitors in Dutch, but I don't know. And for those of you who are not familiar with this phenomenon that's taken over the world, essentially the idea is it is a lot like every other reality show you've ever seen, in that it is a bunch of people stuck together in a house together for a while, and they compete in tasks to get money that they can win at the end. But the twist in Traitors is that there are three or more. There's a number of traitors in the house who basically are killing people every night.
Wait, hold on.
It's like mafia.
I was gonna say it's just like Werewolf basically, but like
it's basically mafia meets Survivor minus starvation.
God, I wish somebody pitched this show to me as that, because that sounds fantastic.
It is. So the thing that I'm pitching really is like, I have been having a lot of fun watching this with a friend of mine, and I don't really ever, because of my sort of sick need to complete all of television and movies, I never really get to experience like disposable media. And I know this is not like a new thing to everybody. They invented entire apps for this whole thing, so I'm not like revealing to you guys that you can have these like sort of like throwaway pieces of media, but it is really fun. I don't know if this show's good. I would never watch it by myself. Everyone in it is like both really evil and stupid and unlikable. It's hard to get invested in anybody, but it is really fun to just like talk shit about it. I'm having a ton of, weirdly, despite the fact that I don't like anybody, still invested in who eventually comes out and wins. We're still only on the first series. I think there's two UK series, and now there's two US ones. The UK one is hosted by Claudia Winkleman, who I adore. I think she's hilarious and also crazy. And the US one is hosted by Alan Cumming, who's also equally crazy. Which I think eventually we'll get to. We'll make it through our way through it very slowly. But I love the, it's just fun. It's fun talking shit. All the people are really shockingly goofy. And like, I don't know how, I'm fascinated by
the, are they like, are they the
people?
Yeah, are they just like regular people?
They're all, well, regulars doing a lot of work.
I meant like
they're
comedians.
No, they're all like accountants and.
I don't consider comedians regular people.
There is one stand-up comedian, but it's weird. She's not funny
scum
at
of
all.
The earth. If you ever improvised in real life, I don't fucking trust you.
I saw some, I can't remember what it was, a tweet life. Or something on the internet. Maybe it was like a read reel on Instagram or something, where there was a woman saying that all the men she would only ever date men who did improv because they were like trustworthy. I was like, white people have different they live in a different universe than us. White women and white men are like somewhere else.
She's dated very few improvisers then.
I say this as somebody who has never and would never do improv, so I'm not, you know, listen.
I'm saying this to someone who has done improv. I'm a sick fuck.
It is, but yeah, the traitors, again, like I said, I'm not necessarily pitching the show in itself. Like, don't, I would not say boot this up on Peacock and watch it by yourself in your house. But if you got someone you like talking shit with and just want some, like, pretty goofy television that is still really gripping. I mean, the show is so dramatic in a way that's really funny. Like, somebody gets eliminated every night, and every morning they come in and eat breakfast, and like they come in one by one, and all these people who again met each other about like 3 days ago at the time of the episode we were in are like weeping tears when these people that they don't know get eliminated. they're like staring at the door like, oh my god, I hope Lucy's here still. And then Chet walks in and they all break down in tears. It's so great.
Need to make a Squid Game fictional TV show about this where the people actually get killed.
But yeah, the Traitors UK or the Traitors generally, or just like, you know, actually, you know what? Ours are more related than I originally realized, because it's really about sharing something with people you care about.
Okay. All right.
How are you going to no-sell me on that, Corey? I really made this beautiful circle connected the dots between Richard Linklater's seminal film Before Sunrise and the experience of watching truly dog shit television with somebody you care about. And you fucking sold me up the river.
Okay. So
I'm going to call Jai Courtney the good Nazi to put you down. You better watch
fuck
yourself.
Off. All right. So as you can tell, my list is no longer in order. So my next thing I want to kind of talk about is... I just saw yesterday, as I mentioned right before this, I saw Ghostbusters Frozen Empire. And the reason, one reason I put this on the list, I have not really watched anything new in theaters since Dune. And I saw Dune twice in theaters because I'm that person, apparently.
Everyone should have seen Dune in theaters twice or seven
nothing
times.
Else was out. And I got my first seat was on the right side. I had to get right in the middle. The old lady next to me wouldn't let me text on my phone in the trailer, so I stared at her for half the film.
No, that's I'm like a real fully insane when it comes to movies. I don't care what you do during the trailers though. You talk, sleep.
She had some big ass glasses on, and she was very apologetic about it because she said it was like the glare is like really bad for me right
now. Fair enough.
And I was like, shut the fuck up. I didn't see no video about putting my phone away, lady.
I'm surprised. You should have gone to the theater to go see Problemista like I did.
I'm going to see that eventually.
I regretted that decision.
But I don't know. I'm bringing up Ghostbusters Frozen Empire because I remember on this podcast, at least to Che, maybe it wasn't on the podcast that I really did like Afterlife.
I think it was the thing you loved when it
was. Yeah, I think it was. I think it hit a lot of bones. Obviously the producers, like, we want to kind of make Stranger Things and Ghostbusters as a baby. Which, I mean, they put fucking Finn Wolfhard in. And, you know, I got to say this right now? Kind of sick of Finn Wolfhard. I don't think I like the stick. I don't know, man. Wow. I don't know.
Can we legally say that about Finn Wolfhard, beloved child star from the television show Stranger Things and the film It? Can we say that about Finn Wolfhard?
Maybe he just didn't work in this film then.
I'll be honest.
I don't know.
I don't really care about Finn Wolfhard one way or the other. I saw that movie he made last year, When You Finish Saving the World, and I was like, this guy is a solid C-. He's just okay at everything.
He's like, his shtick, it works sometimes. I just don't think the stick really worked this time, in a sense. It's weird to me now because he's like an adult now. And yeah. he's still in that mode. And I'm like, I don't believe the child actors have to stay as child actors, but it just kind of feels like, I don't think he really is like at this, is in a weird point of his career. Like the whole man-child part of his career. And I feel like that's like kind of always a very difficult thing to navigate that, especially in comedic roles, like not like dramatic roles, but like in comedic roles when you're kind of playing that same. Because he's play. I mean, unfortunately, they have him play the same character from Stranger Things to It to this. It's like the same guy, basically, which not his fault, really, but he's actually not my issue with this film, though. Before I get into it, I do think this film was fun. But I think this film was a little bit soulless, which kind of bothered me a bit. It just kind of felt like things were happening, and they were telling me things that I was supposed to be emotional, but I really didn't have any emotion with it. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I also was having fun. It was a weird combination of things. And I'm like, for every character actor who's like, why are you here? There was like a James Acaster. Mm-hmm. For every time I'm like, this is pointless, there was another like fun encounter with Ghost, and like we're back in the library and shit like that. And it was like just a really strange viewing experience. I really did feel like Afterlife had a lot of like love and like you did something different with the franchise. And maybe just going back to New York made it kind of feel very like kind of just doing the same thing over again and really having nothing really new to do with it. Mm-hmm. But like characters making stupid decisions just for the sake of plot, like nothing really, a lot of it just didn't make sense. And Paul Rudd's sincerity cannot carry a film like all the way through. He can try, and his scenes are very nice, and I like to see him be, like, a nice guy and do his best, but it's just, I don't know, it's just, I didn't hate it, I had fun, but I just kind of feel weird about it. I don't think I've had, like, an experience with a film like this in a while, and I don't know, I just kind of wanted to bring it up, because, I mean, this is the last thing I've seen in theaters, but it was just a very strange, like, I didn't expect to go in there for, like, fucking Oscars, or even to be as good as the first one, just based off of reviews, but, I don't know, I felt hollow leaving it.
I think for me, in a lot of ways, that is the modern Jason Reitman experience, who has made a lot of movies that I, like, really, truly adore. I, like, Up in the Air, I love. I love Up in the Air. I think it's in contention for one of the best George Clooney performances ever. I really love Young Adults, and I find, like, Thank You for Smoking really fun and interesting as far as, like, comedic filmmaking.
I did really like Thank You for Smoking as a kid.
But he also has made like Juno and
people like Juno,
The Front Runner, and these movies that I find to be like, I think like you're describing, like sort of missing something really important.
But okay, here's what I'm gonna say, this
finger on what I don't love about them.
I'm saying this real quick though. Mm-hmm. He didn't direct. He didn't direct this one.
Did he not?
I thought he did. No, he directed Afterlife. He wrote this one.
He's only screenplay. Okay.
And I mean, in a way, though, I feel like that might have been what was missing. Mm. I think he direct. I thought his directing definitely came through a lot. Oh, yeah, for this, but
Gil Keenan, who
and
I don't know this guy at all.
He's done like, looks like he's done Corey. Mostly
Corey. Hold the fuck up. Do you know what seminal film from our childhood Gil Keenan directed?
Holy shit, he did Monster House.
He did Monster House.
Did we like that film?
Banger. I mean, I liked it in 2006. I don't think
we saw it in theaters though, right?
I think so.
It was like one of my first like horror films, I think. And I get why they would pick someone like this, because it definitely feels a bit more like coming of, not even coming of age. It's just a weird thing about it. It should have been a coming of age story, but it wasn't. It didn't. I don't know. It just felt like they were so much missing the plot of what it like was trying to be.
Well, just based on the cast itself, I said this to somebody who hasn't seen the movie. It just feels like they were trying to do too much shit at one time. You have like
it was so
the
many
next
people
generation
in it.
Of kids plus the old generation with Bill Murray
and my thing though is like they brought in characters from the first one. I'm like you should have been trimming the fat.
Right.
And they brought in characters who literally don't do anything. I'm still annoyed that there's a character called Podcast. And that kid went through puberty so hard. I'm like, who the fuck is this guy? For like 30 minutes. And I'm like, and then he says his name out loud. I'm like, oh, good for you, buddy. You got like you grew about a foot.
Well, I think it's pretty easy to come off of, and let's be honest, the movie is not as bad as the internet tries to pretend it is. The 2016.
Oh, it's not. No. Yeah.
But I think it's pretty easy to come off of that and be like, okay, let's take some risks and like introduce some new blood into this after we basically destroyed the franchise in the fans' eyes, at least. And once that was pretty successful or relatively successful, I think it's pretty hard to get executives not to try to like shamelessly cash in on it. I mean, like I said, like it's weird that there's an entire cast of the kids in this movie, and then also the original cast, and then also Paul Rudd and Carrie Coon and Camille Nanjiani. It's like, what's going on? What are they doing?
That's what I'm saying. They could have trimmed the fat so... Right. There's so many points they could have trimmed the fat. And I think... That's the thing, like, there was, like, there's, like, it's supposed to be, I get, it's supposed to be the whole passing the torch thing, but the people who are holding the torch really don't want to let it go. And they could be, like, in, like, one cameo. Like, the idea with Bill Burr, he was in two scenes, and that was fine. But, like, Dan Aykroyd and, Dan Aykroyd is in it way too much. Ernie Hudson is in it just way too much. And it's just, like, it's like, you know, it's just like, let it transition. Like, let it be something different. I mean, let's, like, at least with the afterlife one, they only show up at the very end. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, this is a nice little cameo. That should have been their goodbye. Fucking hell, Harold Ramis's character, like, officially die and, like, go on to heaven. Like, it could have been like one or two cameos, but they just were in the film so much. And I don't know, it's like one part is just like, hey, it's nice to see the old guys, but another part is like also like, you know, like, if you want to do the old guys, don't give me so much of these new characters. Get rid of some of them.
I also wonder, as two people who are admittedly not, like, Ghostbuster heads. Like, I think we both like the original, but are not. It's not our childhood. We don't have an emotional connection to it the way that a lot of people
from the 90s.
Right, yeah. So I wonder if, like, people who really, really love the 84 Ghostbusters are really stoked about this one.
No, of course not, dude. It's about a little girl now. It's not about a bunch of four, like, straight men. Of course they're not happy about it. Come on,
I think we forget how wild the first Ghostbusters is.
Oh, yeah, there's a lot of shit in there that's just not okay.
It's not a kids movie. It literally isn't a kids movie.
Why did Bill Murray bring drugs to Sigourney Weaver's house to knock her out? There's some
because the 80s were problematic.
Absolutely.
Oh, no, the Ghostbusters in 1984 is PG. There's...
Yeah.
Am I bugging, or is there not nudity in that movie?
I think Dan Aykroyd gets a blowjob in his dream from a ghost.
But it's not actual... Like, is Sigourney Weaver naked in that movie?
She's not naked. I think she's just, like, wearing, like, a very, like... skimpy dress, I think. I can't remember.
But there is a sex scene. It's mostly played for laughs. There's definitely a sex scene. Imagine there being a sex scene in a PG movie today. There's barely sex scenes in R-rated movies today. That's so wild. That's true. That movie's PG. That's crazy. Then again, there was, like, was Terminator PG Happy Meal kit, Happy Meal toys, and that movie
exactly
is fucking lit.
Yeah, RoboCop 2. It's just like, yeah, like, that's a bunch of dicks could shut up in that movie. Yeah. But yeah, Chill, what you got? I'm tired. I don't like dunking on things for too long, but yeah, it just kind of made me a little bit like, it's like so weird to be like something like, this is like I think like this is what you should do with like a spiritual, like as like successor, like later on the day, like the first one, I'm like, you took the concept, you kept it with it and kind of did something different with it, but you kind of like kept the spirit of it, no pun intended. But like this was like kind of more of like, this is the exact opposite of what I don't like for these things, where you're just doing retreading of the same thing. And I don't need to see Slimer for every movie. I don't need him. I don't need the dude. Like, I don't.
What's the most successful version of this?
What do you mean?
Like the reboot of a beloved franchise. Has it ever really worked?
Not like in, I don't think like an 80s one. I'm not counting like old movie remakes or reboots, but like. Not like one of these type of films is
I've Googled the words best reboot movies and some good contenders have come up. Sorry, I just hit my mic. Good contenders have come up. Rise of the Planet of the Apes, which I fuck with.
I was thinking about that one, but I feel like that's different.
Especially because it's a prequel. It's sort of, but I think it can count. We've got Mad Max Fury Road.
Okay.
I count Star that. Trek.
I can count that. I like the first Star Trek was good.
We've got Bumblebee, which I think
we count that.
I count it only because it's like a miracle that movie is good, which I think it is actually genuinely pretty fucking good. And to reboot a terrible franchise with no good movies and make a pretty good one is pretty incredible. We've got some sketchy ones in here too. For some reason, the Spike Lee version of Old Boy is considered a reboot. It's not. It's a shot-for-shot remake of a much better movie that nobody asked for. We've got The Magnificent Seven.
Another movie that no one asked for, but
I still kind of like that movie. I'm not going to lie.
I like it.
As good as the first one, in any stretch, or the original, as any stretch of the imagination. But I mean, the list gets pretty thin after the first three. I think we're talking basically Rise of the Planet of the Apes, Star Trek, Mad Max Fury Road, and then if we're counting it, Casino Royale, the reboot of James Bond. But I that feels like a cheat because they basically reboot James Bond every...
I don't count that, but I mean, like, there's, like, not been, like, one of, like, set in the same universe many years later, and it's, like, turns out to be, like, successful.
I think Mad Max and Rise of the Planet of the Apes are the only ones that I would...
But even then, like, I mean, I guess it doesn't feel like it, though. I don't know if that makes sense. I guess Mad Max feels like it a bit more than Planet of the Apes, I guess, to me.
Yeah, and the thing about Planet of the Apes, at least, is that, like, it's very much kind of like Ghostbusters in that, or really it's more like Alien and Terminator we were talking about earlier, where it's one really good movie and then a lot of years of people like trying their best to capitalize on the IP and failing miserably, and then suddenly three really good movies again.
I mean, if we're going to compare this to like we were talking about earlier, like Alien, like Predator, like Terminator, that's kind of like from that era.
Prometheus is definitely like, I would say Prometheus is probably a reboot of the...
Yeah, Prometheus. I mean, yeah, and I guess like Afterlife is also the same thing where it's like same universe later on. Or in like Prometheus' case, it was a prequel. Mm-hmm. And I think those both worked. But like, you know, all the Terminators have been pretty bad. Like,
it's besides almost like them, this is, I mean, probably Predator, not a good idea and we should stop doing it. And stop, but the thing, and maybe I'm like, make original ideas.
That's true. But also Prey slapped. So it's like, you know, like it's...
Prey did slap, yeah.
Prey slept.
But Predators is one of the worst movies I've ever seen. So it's like...
No. You're thinking of Predator.
Sorry, I'm talking about The Predator.
The Predator.
Predators.
Wait, hold on. Predators is Predator a better franchise than Alien and Terminator?
Predator 1, take? Incredible. Yes. Obviously. A classic of the genre. Predator 2, I liked as a kid and is probably quite bad.
I think it's like I remember watching it in the
New York subway for some reason, right?
LA. It's very strange.
But why is it in the LA subway system?
It makes no sense, but it's weirdly enjoyable, but not that good.
Yeah.
Alien vs. Predator, bad. Alien vs. Predator 2 Requiem, also bad. Predators, good. Ooh. Bad, fun, good. The Predator, bad. Prey, good.
I don't know. It will all be decided with Badlands, Dan Trachtenberg's follow-up to Prey, which is coming out next year. If that's good, we have a content. We have.
Is that Australia?
Probably, right? Called Badlands.
Well, Australians.
I think this actually, maybe this is a whole episode. We could argue the seminal 80s and 90s action genres that have been like beaten to death. Like, I also think Die Hard is really in this conversation. Like, is Die Hard a better franchise in totality than the other ones? Die Hard 1, obviously a classic. Die Hard 2, okay. Die Hard 3, fully bangs. After that, we have questions.
I like Live Free or Die Hard, if I remember correctly, but it is a very different film than the first one. That's Justin Long, right? Yeah, I like Justin
Long. So weird. And then suddenly Jai Courtney in the 2013 one.
Yeah, he's his son.
Yeah, because they look the same.
He was in this...
All right. Anything else to say about classic 80s action movies before we move on to my number four?
No, man, go ahead.
All right, my number four is a book I think I've talked about on this podcast before, but I don't remember. And that is Interior Chinatown by Charles Yu. I started this back in like November. And then had to put it down because we obviously get really crunched for time when December rolls around. And I just picked it back up recently. I'm about three quarters of the way through. And I'm really loving this book. I decided to start reading it. It had been on my list for a while. And the reason the impetus for starting it originally, and I guess starting it again, was that there's a TV series coming out, an adaptation of the book, later this year. I don't know if there's a specific date for it yet. But I'm not quite finished, but I'm happy to say I love this book. I think Yu has this real grasp of prose that I find really fantastic and like innovative. And it's this beautiful, scathing, funny indictment of American culture as it relates to its relation to like Asian American people, but specifically like Asian American masculinity and in relation to Hollywood, and the way that he uses the interiority of his main character is like, I think really fascinating. I worry now that I've read the book that this show is going to be quite bad because I don't know how you adapt a book that is this set inside the main character's mind. It's essentially, I think most of the interesting stuff that's happening in this book is all in this guy's head, and all him narrating to himself. And I also have had this rule for a while that I think I've talked about on this podcast, where I think the best books to adapt are good stories poorly written. And that's why I think George R. R. Martin is a great adaptation subject, because I think George R. R. Martin is probably a good storyteller, although we may never find that out in actuality because he will never finish his books, but is not a very good writer. While I don't think the story of Willis Wu in Interior Chinatown is necessarily the most interesting part, while I think Yu's writing is really the impetus for like what is successful about this book. And I'm fascinated but worried to see the adaptation of this. But if you're looking for, this book has been obviously incredibly popular. That's why it's being adapted into a show. If you haven't checked this out, it won the National Book Award for Fiction in 2020. So it's like, I'm not obviously not pitching anything super indie to any of you. This book is really fun, really good. If you like Hollywood or even just like American culture, or just great writing in general, I think you stuff is worth checking out. I have his other book. This is his second book. His first one is next to gonna be next up on my list. I haven't read it either. How to Live Safely in a Science Fiction Universe. Great title.
That's a great title.
Yeah. But big fan of this book. I highly recommend. Yeah. And I think we will talk about this show when it comes out, mostly out of morbid curiosity. Like I said, I don't really know how they're going to do it. But hopefully it's good. I would love
to. Sounds really interesting.
Yeah.
I'm going to give this guy a shot. You know, it sounds like a good book. I'm still in the middle of many books, and unfortunately, I just started another one, so, because I'm a psychopath.
Yeah, I have that problem where I'm like, oh, this is a good book. I'll start it again, and then just don't. I'm bad at finishing books in a timely manner.
My fucking problem is, like, whenever I watch something sci-fi, I'm like, I need to know more about the lore, and then I'm like, I can't be reading so many fucking sci-fi books.
Yeah, see, I usually have the opposite reaction. I don't really know what instigated my decision to read this book, because usually I'm the opposite, where I'm like, I would rather read the book after the movie or the show, so it doesn't taint my
entire. Yeah, I usually do that, but I think to me sometimes when I'm like watching something, and I guess I'll talk about this later on in the episode, but when I'm watching something and I think it's like, this is good, but I'm kind of more interested in the concept and story of it rather than like what you're doing like with the camera and the acting, I think that's when I'm like, let me go pick up the book.
Yeah.
But like, for example, with Dune, I'm like, nah, I don't. I need to just give me Denny's vision, then I'll go back and read it later on.
Dune is a perfect example because I read the first Dune so long ago, and I barely remember the book. And I think a lot of my memories of the plot of the book have been like shaped and formed by me having watched the movies recently, and like how much of that is false memory versus what is like really me remembering the book. I'm not entirely clear, but I'm actually not. Weirdly, or maybe not that weirdly, no interest in going back and reading ahead. Like, I don't really want to know.
Oh, no, I don't plan to read it. I don't plan to read ahead, though, but it's like kind of nice to get people like a little bit of like the backdrop of
after the final Dune movie. I'll probably go back and check them out just
I think it's only, it's only going to be like, I'm only going to guess it's probably like one more movie. I don't know.
I would assume so,
but I don't think there's been any kind. I think he's doing another film in between this and Messiah, but I think he's, apparently he already gave the script to Hans Zimmer to get started, so I'm sure.
Why to Hans? Like I said, I love Hans Zimmer. Why does he get the first one?
Got to make that weird music, dude. We got to hear that fucking wailing shit, man.
Doesn't he need? Never mind. You know what? Never mind.
To get the break, get the chemistry going, man. You know.
Let's take a quick break, and we'll come back and do our top three in a maybe more timely manner. We're so late as always. All right, I'll be right back.
And by the way, I know it kills you, but guess what? There is no Danny's idea. Everything that comes in here belongs to the agency.
You mean you?
As long as you still work here.
Is that a threat? Because I've already taken somebody up on one of those tonight.
Relax.
You know what? Here's a blank piece of paper. Why don't you turn that into glow coat?
Are you out of your mind? You gave me 20 ideas, and I picked out one of them that was a kernel that became that commercial.
So you remember?
I do. It was something about a cowboy. Congratulations.
No, it was something about a kid locked in a closet because his mother was making him wait for the floor to dry, which is basically the whole commercial.
It's a kernel.
Which you changed just enough so that it was yours.
I changed it into a commercial. What, are we gonna shoot him in the dark in the closet? That's the way it works. There are no credits on commercials.
But you got the Clio.
It's your job. I give you money, you give me ideas.
And you never say thank you.
That's what the money is for.
And we're back.
What's up?
All right, next up with, I mean, the 5 minutes thing is not really been adhered to by either of us.
You can kiss my ass.
With five-ish minutes on the clock, Angry Cory is going to pitch a comic book.
I will be a lot quicker with these ones. I don't think I really have much to say until my number one, I think, is probably my last conversational point, really. Mm-hmm. But my next one is, like, as the X-Men has been, unfortunately, I feel like I've been talking about this forever. And I'm really wondering, in retrospect, how it's going to be, like, collected and read. But this weird
that's
age...
That's what I thought 95% of the time when I'm reading a Marvel book. It's like, what fucking order are they going to put this in when they collect it into a book?
Exactly. Like, that's my thing about it. And I'm really wondering, like, and I think at some point, when the X-Men's Krakoa age is finally done, I think I'm going to sit down and do some kind of content to figure out what is necessary to have been read to, like, what end. Because it seems like Marvel's very much like, okay, this was fun, but we're trashing it. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how to feel about that, because I think this age of X-Men comics has been, like, the most fun I've ever had as, like, an actual reader, like, picking up month to month. It's been confusing as hell at some times, but when I'm actually, like, in the throes of it, understand where the story's going, I'm absolutely enjoying it. And I think the highlight for me has been Al Ewing's writing. Throughout the series, he did, like, X-Men Red and a couple other books throughout the series. But, I mean, he's just been general doing a great job. He's obviously doing Immortal Thor right now, and he did the great Immortal Hulk series. Mm. But the two characters I love that he's been working on the most recently has been Storm and Magneto. And I think the one I'm highlighting the most right now is the current miniseries Resurrection of Magneto. Magneto died in... I mean, like, you know, comic book characters just die all the time. But Magneto died defending, like, the mutants' Mars kingdom. I just love comic books sometimes. It just
sounds so... Do you
think
if we had a website that was just... It was called, like, arethedeadnow.com, and it was just a list of all of the biggest superhero comic books characters in DC and Marvel, and it was just a fucking Excel sheet that said yes or no? Do you think that would get any traffic?
I think it actually might. It actually might be like
every once in a while, I have to text you and be like, "Hey, is fucking like Johnny Storm dead right now or something?"
That's the problem with it though. Is like, I mean, like, I'm not gonna get into the whole problem with death and resurrection in comic books, but
we've,
like,
talked about it many times before.
It's just like, I think to me, as it's happened now, is that none of the deaths really have meaning anymore.
Is the big issue with it, yeah.
But the way that you handle the resurrections or the death themselves, that's what makes it good. Mm-hmm. And Magneto died basically when a angry ass, like, what the fuck are they called? Eternal.
I was like, I hope you're not fucking asking me.
Oh, I'm sorry. But, like, yeah, no, the Eternals were just, the evil Eternals were being dickheads and went to go fucking war on the mutants. And basically a big old evil one punched a hole in Magneto's chest and ripped out his heart.
Remember when there was like an Eternals movie and we were like, this will be the future of the MCU?
No, never saying that word, those words out loud. But basically, through the power of sheer will, Magneto kept himself alive for another like 30 minutes, and then he eventually died. And he was like, hey, don't bring me back. I'm cool with being dead. I'm done. Because, I mean, the X-Men have the whole resurrection thing right now. So it's been like, all right, Magneto's dead. Like, let me be dead. Just leave me the fuck alone.
Real Goku type shit.
Exactly. Except he doesn't. Well, he does have kids he doesn't like, though. Actually, you know, it's a lot of parallels if you think about it out loud.
Is there ever like a long 14 issue run of X Men where Magneto's simply doing push ups the entire time because for some reason that's what the creator decided to have this main character do?
We will not have any slander against Akira Toriyama.
No slander. Guess the great man. Rest in peace to a legend. I just remember as a kid watching that season, being like, "Hey, is Goku gonna get to Earth this episode?"
It's like that scene, this is a random ass pull for like Kung Pao, and like it's
what?
Like
what Kung Pao,
yeah, you remember Kung Pao? It's like that really weird, like, It's like this white dude like photoshops himself into like a Chinese martial arts film and just poorly dubs it. Have you never heard of Kung Pao? I've
never heard of Kung Pao, I don't think.
I don't think it's good anymore, but at the time it was like peak 10-year-old comedy to me.
Kung Pao Enter the Fist.
Yes, no, but there's a scene the guy's like running into, like he's like doing the whole like run and he's just not getting any closer.
Yeah.
That's how I feel like those kind of things. Like, yeah, I'm on my way there, and it's just like in the distance, like he's like, I'm coming at some point. It's just like
I just remember logs. I mean, I could be exaggerating it in my memory. I just remember long swaths of that season where literally just Goku like turning up the gravity in his ship that was coming back to Earth and doing push-ups. And even as a kid, I remember being like, "Well, this feels like a waste of everyone's time."
I mean, that's the weird thing about it. Let me just wrap up. I'll wrap up Magneto real quick. Sorry. It's okay, and I'll come back to your point with that. But I think the interesting thing what Ewing's doing with it is like he's just kind of using a lot of Marvel, like a lot of the Marvel lore to kind of explore the story, but also just a really interesting like examination of Magneto as a character. Because like, I mean, the dude's like probably been the most like well-fleshed out, one of the most well-fleshed out Marvel characters.
We've said for a while, probably the best villain in Marvel, but maybe the best villain in comic books.
Period. I don't think he's a villain. I mean, he hasn't been a villain for like 20 years.
That's usually
like,
what happens to the great villains is they eventually become heroes, except for
Dr. Doom as well. That guy stays being it.
Well, he was good for a second.
He was good for like 3 years.
Doom was good for a second.
And honestly, I really liked Good Doom. That was fun. Was that Brian Michael Bendis' last good book? Probably.
What do you mean? You don't think Pearl is really great?
Fuck off. But I think like the way that, I think for once it was actually an interesting way to look at the character being like, he is this character who's done a lot of horrible, horrible shit. He's killed a lot of fucking people. But also this other character, the other character's like, I'm trying to do better. I'm trying to do good. And he's like this person who's like evolving, really. Which I don't think a lot of like comic book characters really get a chance to look back and do. You kind of like have to have a character who like understands and recognizes that like, I haven't really been a good dude all the time. I've been like mostly a shitty person. And even though I try to do all the things that are good, doesn't really counteract that. And I think it's a really interesting moral like question he does. And I think the way that it's written and drawn is just so well done. And you add in basically the moral anchor who's trying to basically drag him out of the pit is Storm. And it's just like two of my favorite X-Men characters being thrust into this like kind of like journey out of the underworld kind of situation. I think it's only on issue 3. I thought it was really good so far. But little known fact, they're tying into Dragon Ball Z after this, not the whole thing about this, but in reference to a comic, in reference to our podcast, Next Time On is actually named after Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah.
But little known fact right there. And I didn't realize that, but it was in the back of my mind for so long, and then I'm like, oh wait, that's where I fucking got the title from.
Yeah.
Much later on, but I didn't realize it at first.
Yeah, I all love for Dragon Ball Z.
Remember how fucking long it took for him to kill Frieza? That was like a year. That was like a year of my life. I remember, like, it's like there was an episode every day, and it took him like a fucking year to kill Frieza.
I think a large part of why I'm pretty anti-anime now is my experience with Dragon Ball Z, which I did like. Let me be very clear: I liked Dragon Ball Z as a kid,
but it's
I
just remember being like,
I don't have 50 fucking episodes to watch you do a thing. I just don't.
That's the thing about. I think that's the biggest problem with people looking at that in the reference point. It's just the pacing of those shows can be so...
Is it One Piece like over 1,000 episodes right now?
Yeah, easily.
About fucking stretchy pirates?
That's hey, don't. Let's not go there. Apparently Netflix is doing the whole, like, let's just kind of, like, sum it up real quick or, like, make a shorter version. I mean, like, look at Full Metal Alchemist. It's like, they did, like, 50 episodes and that's, like, 50, done. This is good. Cowboy Bebop had 24 episodes and has more like...
That's Cowboy Bebop and Samurai Champloo are still elite because of that.
I think he's doing another show. Doing another show coming up. I don't remember that. I don't know when that's coming out, but I'm really excited for it.
Will I be watching my first anime in like 20 years?
There's some good stuff out there. But
yeah, but I won't watch it, so it doesn't matter.
It's okay. It's okay. Don't worry about it. I'm never going to make you watch anything.
I remember I had a very long argument.
Pluto's good. You'd like Pluto.
That's fine. I had a very long argument with somebody about why I won't watch anime, and it's pretty simple.
Watch Pluto.
It's pretty simple. I'll explain it to you now since it came up. I hate people who watch anime. They're my least favorite human beings on the earth.
Rude.
Corey, you hate me, I hate you. That's how this podcast thrives.
That's fair.
And we love each other. It's real. It causes real tension. But that's number one. Number two is that there's just too many good live action things. And I've just made the decision that if I ever got to the point where I finished all the movies and all the TV that I wanted to watch, and then there was this long stack of anime there, sure, I'll go watch it. But there's just no reason for me to sit down and watch fucking My Hero Academia when I haven't finished the entire catalog of Francois Truffaut or, you know,
no
other stuff.
Don't say you know to me like I'm gonna agree with you. I don't agree with you, but that's fine. Have your thing. Some days I want a chocolate cookie dough ice cream. Sometimes I want Cherry Garcia. That's just life, man.
But the thing is, I never want banana ice cream, and that's what anime
rude
is
rude as shit. That's fucked up. That's fucking rude.
Hey, I'm just really seeding the YouTube comments here. You see if we're
you really reaction. It's just like, dude, I think you just like really like you're like the hot takes guy. Be like, this one come like you're listen. Don't talk shit about My Hero Academia.
I have no opinions on it. I've never seen them. My Hero Academia could be incredible or it could be shit. I have no idea, and I will
Someone who still watches some anime, I hate myself. Okay, what's number three?
What I'm pitching is
this is my new favorite episode. It's just truly, truly deranged.
Is the 2000s film by recent Oscar winner Jonathan Glazer. And that is Sexy Beast.
Sir, I'm afraid you can't smoke.
What do you want?
Your cigarette. You have to put it out.
Cigarette? What? This? No, I'm not going to put it out.
You must.
What's that?
If you don't, we can't take off.
Well, that's your problem, isn't it? It's your move.
I'm afraid you can't.
No, I'm not going to pull it out. You're just going to have to wait. I've finished it. As simple as that.
Why don't you just put the cigarette out?
What's that, Sancho? You want me to cut your hands off, use it as an ashtray? Yeah, I'll pull it out, providing you're prepared to let me stub it out on your eyeball. I'll pull it out. Agreeable? No. Here come the gay brigade, look.
I'll tell you what. I'll get off the plane. You happy with that? I'm happy with that. I'll smack it outside. Open the door. I hope this crashes. Open the fucking door!
Obviously, after being sort of like... For those of you who have heard us talk about it, you know, we don't need to go in anymore. We both were pretty fascinated and sort of taken with Zone of Interest. And I also saw Under the Skin for the first time since it came out in theaters like over a decade ago. I went to the theater to see that. They did a re-release at the Alamo, which was interesting. I'd never seen it on the big screen. I'd only ever seen it like... I think probably on my fucking laptop in 2014 or something like that. And I've been pretty fascinated with Jonathan Glazer, who I think is a filmmaker kind of like Richard Linklater, where he feels like his films are quite disconnected. Not disconnected, but like he's a very diverse filmmaker who's made a lot of different kinds of movies, but has this pretty strong through line of a theme. And I think the theme that he's really fascinated with, which for me has been cemented by the Zone of Interest, is he seems really fascinated with the lengths of depravity that humanity will steep to. And Sexy Beast is a movie I'd never seen before. It's the first time I've ever seen it. The last of, I think, his feature-length films that I haven't seen. I'm not 100% sure. I think so. And for those of you who don't know what Sexy Beast is, there is a prequel show on Paramount Plus that just came out. I have no idea if it's good or not. I wanted to watch this before I dove into that. Hopefully it is good. But basically the idea is this ex-criminal, Gal Dove, played by Ray Winstone, giving like a pretty off-key performance for him. I think that's kind of the point, is he's really cast as... Obviously, Ray Winstone, famously like the big tough gangster in almost everything, just did a good job in the Gentleman Show, which was really fun. But in this, he's like this sort of he's softened, basically. He's a gangster who's in his later years after a life of crime, has tried to retire to this beautiful villa in Spain with his wife and their friends, and that whole idyllic life is really thrown into chaos when Ben Kingsley, also giving a pretty off-kilter performance for him, comes in and is playing like a true depraved psychopath. And I use psychopath like in the clinical definition of it. Like, this guy is dangerously crazy. And it's funny because, like, for me, Ben Kingsley, in my experience as a film viewer, has always been like sort of the affable, lovable grandfather figure. Obviously, most famously, probably in like Gandhi,
Prince of Persia.
Fucking Gandhi. Also, Prince of Persia and Schindler's List, three equally good movies. And then, of course, like his character in Iron Man 3, which I actually think is like a really interesting performance in like a pretty weird decision narratively.
Weird decision, but like after knowing the twist is happening, much better film.
Oh yeah, but, like, for sure.
That movie is so much better on the second watch through. First it's watch also, through.
They should have just not made it the Mandarin, who was like a
No, they just really just didn't have to do that. Yeah.
But I wonder if that was in an attempt to sort of like, because the Mandarin is a relic of a really dark time in Marvel Comics history. Pretty racist character. Straight up racist character.
Smarter to move it over to the Middle East and just doing China, because that was weird. But then at the same time, well, I guess then Shang-Chi kind of proved that there was China later on. So yeah, no, smarter decision.
Yeah. But Ben Kingsley's performance is great. Ray Winstone's really good in this. Also, Ian McShane, who's a more minor role in this, is also quite good. I think the thing that I really loved about Sexy Beast, and I think the thing I love about Jonathan Glazer movies in general, is what he does is he seems to take classic structures of films, Sexy Beast being like, on the surface, seems like a gangster film, like a one last job type deal.
It seems like, from reading the description, it definitely does seem like,
It feels like it's in that time, and I'm sure he's responding to this, like in that time in the 90s and 2000s, that was all this huge burst of these types of films coming out after the success of Reservoir Dogs and Pulp Fiction and Tarantino like bursting onto the scene, and all these movies with degrees of success and a lot of them really terrible, like caricatures of what a good Tarantino films, of bad guys in rooms talking, like, you know, quick witty banter back and forth, and then at the end there's this huge action set piece, and Sexy Beast I think plays with that idea in a really interesting way, the same way that Zone of Interest plays with a war film in an interesting way, or not really a war film, but like a Holocaust film in an interesting way, the same way that Under the Skin plays with a sci-fi film in an interesting way. And all these films, and Birth, I think one of his least successful films, but also is like trying to do something with the thriller and the mystery genre. But I watched Sexy Beast and you see all these ideas that really, I think, come to a head in Zone of Interest, which I still think is probably his most fully thought out and fleshed out film, and I'm very interested to see where Glazer goes from here. But if you haven't seen Sexy Beast, I would say, one, watch it, really, really great, but also don't go in expecting like the Italian Job. It on its surface it seems like that, but this movie is really about this is a bit of a spoiler, but I will just say, like, the heist in this movie is I think like 3 minutes. It's such a short part of the film and like sort of comes out of nowhere. It just starts happening and you're like, okay. And then it ends, but it's because it's not really actually the focus of the film. The focus of the film is this character Gal Dove and his like trying to escape from the evils of his past, quite literally manifested in this character, Don Logan, played by Ben Kingsley, giving a really fantastic performance. I really loved it. It's on, I think it's on Hulu right now. I watched it on the Criterion Channel, but it is leaving March 31st. So if you don't see it before then, it'll be somewhere. I'm sure it's somewhere else. You can find all the shit all over the place. But really worth checking out if you guys haven't seen it.
I'll definitely check it out.
And it's like a pretty quick, I never complain about a long movie. We've had this conversation before in relation to like Killers of the Flower Moon and Oppenheimer, but If you're looking for like a quick hitter, it's an hour and 28 minutes. In and out, fast paced. Ray Winstone's great. Ben Kingsley's great. Ian McShane's great. Amanda Redman, great.
I mean, especially like after Zone of Interest, I think I really want to go through Jonathan Glazer's filmography and give like definitely Under the Skin. And I mean, now Sexy Beast, I definitely got to go through and get just, you know, just dig through his stuff.
Yeah. So like I said, Zone of Interest was definitely the impetus for me to go back and watch this movie. I saw it pop up on the Criterion channel, and they were obviously like, because his name has been in the news for that movie, that they were pushing it. And I'm glad I watched it. I'm glad he's not super prolific yet. I mean, I'm sure he's not done making movies by any stretch of the imagination. So I'm interested to see what is next for him.
For Glazer?
Yeah, John Glazer.
Yeah.
For sure.
I mean, it's one of those things like, yeah, like it's a person whose name I've heard for so long. It's just like kind of, it was like, I didn't realize it was my first of his films really until we were watching. Until like the film started, I'm like, oh wait, I don't think I've actually seen any of his stuff.
Oh, you haven't seen Under the Skin?
No, I have not.
Under the Skin's a weird one. I find it really fascinating. I think it's mostly, it's again, I'm really taken with filmmakers who are also interested with the idea of stardom. It's why I think Fincher really speaks to me, because Fincher is obsessed with movie stardom and like the beauty and an unobtainable beauty of movie, like actors and actresses alike. And Under the Skin is that, but it, like, gross. It's like this movie about Scarlett Johansson literally using her body to capture men. The metaphor is not subtle in any stretch of the imagination. And I'm more fascinated with Scarlett Johansson in that film. And
yeah,
her,
I bet you are.
Her decision to her decision to make it, rather than, I think the film itself is not like, after seeing Zone of Interest and seeing what Glazer is capable of, it's pretty hard to compare the two. I think like one is a true masterpiece, and the other I think is a really interesting piece of cinema, but are not really,
I get what you're saying,
as each other, to be honest.
I mean, it's kind of like, you know, Linklater. It's just like, kind of like, I like it when directors kind of just go all over the place. I mean, Carpenter's probably my favorite director, because he just does so much different shit, but you know, I like it. I like when directors can be that versatile and not just like work themselves into a corner.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
All right, so we got two more each. Mm-hmm. So, and I don't want to hold it. And also, this is another one I really don't think I have too much to say about it. I've just been kind of enjoying it. So Marvel's like kind of finally gotten their Ultimate Comics into a full swing of things. After Che and I's kind of had a bit of a rocky start with Ultimate Invasion. And like then
I liked the idea. I still like the idea.
Like the idea.
I'm fascinated with the return of Ultimate Comics. I thought that comic was like maybe not great.
And I think it's one of those things where, like, I love a good world-building thing, but the story itself in it wasn't the best.
Right.
But now that we have this new universe, I am enjoying it so much. But first up, like, Jonathan Hickman's Ultimate Spider-Man takes later in his life, Spider-Man, already married, successfully married, and nothing's wrong there for once. Uncle Ben's not dead. And he has, like, two
Can
kids.
Can you even be Spider-Man without a dead uncle, though?
No, but he's a dead aunt now.
Oh, like, is it canon?
Uncle Ben's alive.
I guess in Homecoming, yeah. Uncle Ben's also dead, so.
Uncle Ben, yeah, he's just, Spider-Man in the Marvel Cinematic Universe has probably the roughest hang of any Spider-Man anywhere.
In any of the Marvel Universe.
Such a depressing ending of a film. Like, it was incredibly depressing.
It's so pointless. Why? Whatever.
Whatever. But this, like, I mean, at least with Ultimate Spider-Man so far, it's something that I feel like I've always wanted from a Spider-Man comic, where it's like, oh, this is like the stage of his life where he's really not a fuck-up, dealing with different life problems. Having like in the whole universe itself, and the cool thing about the Ultimate Universe is that you can make a bunch of little weird decisions, like having Uncle Ben be alive, and he was used to be the editor-in-chief of the Daily Bugle with J. Jonah Jameson, their best friends, and they do a walkout when Kingpin buys the newspaper. I'm like, that's like fun shit like that, and like Norman Osborn, I mean, Harry Osborn's a Green Goblin because Norman Osborn's already dead, and like just doing different shit like that, and especially like putting it in a different point of their lives where like you find a middle-aged Peter Parker who's very at the point of his life where he feels like something is missing and he's like kind of lost in his own life, and then he now gets this whole second chance of things and gets to try out, like, and gets to become Spider-Man at this point in his life, and how that reflects on him and how he does day-to-day stuff. It's just so, just an interesting idea. I feel like it's just annoying that we've been so perpetually stuck with, like, a Spider-Man who's now technically going to be, he's technically younger than us in the Marvel comics, who's just a perpetual fuck-up, and at this point kind of just makes him feel like a loser.
Yeah.
That's like, you know, at this point kind of just makes me feel bad for the guy, and like, not like a, it doesn't seem like, and I get the whole, no, I don't actually get it. Like, Marvel wants to have characters who are relatable, and those, like, his character is no longer become relatable, because I don't think I know anybody who's just been so much a perpetual fuck-up as this guy has, and not, a, like, and date also, like, 10 supermodels. Like, you know, that, yeah, super relatable.
Yeah, I mean, those guys do exist, though.
But, okay, second up, Ultimate Black Panther, written by Brian Hill. It's only two issues in. I think this guy's just having a lot of fun. Hmm. He's just, like, taking no strings, nothing holding him down. And just seeming to be tell a story of, like... And the good thing about Ultimate Invasion, at least the interesting thing about this world, is that the entire world is now being, like, fought over by these, like kind of, like, evil, like, upper-crust secret society thing. And there's a group pretty much trying to tear up Africa and take control of it. And of course, they're trying to go after Wakanda, who's been like in their own little bubble. So it's like a bunch of individuals doing an aggressive attack on Wakanda. And T'Challa has been kind of like a lame duck king of just kind of being like, we shouldn't do anything until his father's killed. And then he's like, okay, we should do something now. And kind of how that strings out from there. It's interesting though. Like he's already married to Okoye, which is different. But Storm also exists in this universe as well, and she apparently she's also with Killmonger. There's a lot of really cool ideas going on there, and I'm like, okay, I'm interested in it. Ultimate X-Men, still don't know how I feel about it entirely. Peach Momoko has done X-Men Demon Days a couple years back, and Che and I talked about it then. Mm-hmm. This book doesn't feel like a Marvel comic, and I mean that in a good way. I mean, her drawing and style is very like watercolor, very like reminiscent of David Wynn's art from Little Monsters and Descender fame. But really good book. I really am, I'm enjoying the first issue. It definitely felt a lot more of like this weird, like horror comic book coming of age story. And I'm wondering where she's going with it, especially because it's interesting where it's just a singular character focused tale set in Japan where the book is Ultimate X-Men. I don't know. It's like these three, like, I mean, Brian Hill is somebody who I haven't really gotten into recently. So same with Peach, but I mean, Hickman's already proven himself. And it seems like Brian Hill, it seemed like it was a very deliberate decision to take Brian Hill and Peach Momoko as the secondary, like, writers for this relaunch of a universe. In general, it's like, it's nice to, like, kind of feel excited about Marvel again, because I feel like with these stories, and I mean, that's the cyclical nature of, like, mainstream comics where nothing happens sometimes. And it feels like, especially we talk about the death of Magneto and, like, kind of how he's just back again. And I thought the story was well done, but it's just, that's just the nature of shit where nothing really feels, like, different. And it's nice to take familiar characters and do something very different with them, which I'm enjoying. But if you guys haven't checked out any Ultimate comic books yet, I really recommend them all. Even though Ultimate Invasion is a bit of an interesting hang, I think it is a good read now that we have more. Mm-hmm. And now that the universe is actually kind of going. And I think it's better for that. I think that a whole, like, 3-month break between that book and then the beginning of Ultimate Spider-Man was a bit of a mistake, but... I think give it a shot.
I'm interested. Well, one, do people need to read Ultimate Invasion to then read
it? They don't need to read it, but it definitely does. Yeah, because, like, I mean, like, Ultimate Spider-Man spills out of, like, a very big... I mean, I can just give people the background now. Basically, the evil secret society of, like, villains framed Tony Stark in a terrorist attack on New York City, which, like, took out, like, basically a city block and killed a lot of people. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where the universe, like, and Tony Stark is currently on the run from that, but also trying to revive all of these superheroes throughout the universe who have kind of been either hidden or, like, deliberately pushed aside. And Spider-Man was his, like, first, like, go-to, like, being like, this was taken from you, you were supposed to be this superhero, but basically the hand of the universe kind of skewed it around so it never happened to you. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of, I mean, that's kind of basically just what the backdrop is. Like, Aunt May dies in that same terrorist attack, and like things like that's kind of the whole inciting incident that we don't really see for this, but it kind of puts on like at least the feeling that's why the universe is so kind of like on edge thing like that. And yeah, so that's like kind of what like the basically what it is, like a bunch of villains are trying to carve up the world, especially America, Africa, not as much in Japan yet, but it seems like at least most of Africa and America are very much up for grabs. And I think that's kind of where, like, things are playing out now. Very big, like, it feels very big stakes. And I'm interested because these three stories do kind of feel like superheroes who aren't, like, Captain Marvels or, like, kind of like Thors, where it's just, like, they're kind of, like, these smaller heroes and seeing how they reflect. I guess it's, like, kind of in a way, like, kind of a bit boots on the ground where this, like, universe is kind of, like, expanding and going. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, like, it's, like, interesting world building and telling good stories inside of it, which is what comics should be in a combined medium.
Yeah, I think the nature of being beholden to, like, the big story arcs is what I found so frustrating with Marvel
in recent
years. So if them straying away from it sounds like a good idea. I'm still fascinated to see how, because it looks like this seems like this is going to be their plan or their hope that this is the salvation for the MCU. I don't know how this idea gets communicated that well to, like, casual film viewers, but I'm interested to see how they execute it.
Yeah, I think this is a really good idea for people who are movie fans, but they're not really into comics, mm-hmm. where it's just like, I mean, I told you what's happening, but honestly, you can just read Ultimate Spider-Man without any, like, real, like, they'll tell you what happened. They'll spell it out for you. And, like, I think that's a good thing with comics now because some of them feel so convoluted, and I think it's weighing a lot of them just down. So I think this is, like, a very good starting point. I mean, Ultimate Black Panther reads like the comic that should have come out of the movies. Like, this should have been, like, the focus and, like, the way that they styled it out. And I think this was, like, the direction it really needed. And as much as I like Coates' book, it was very weighed down with heavy prose and, like, a lot of ideas going around with it and not just being, like, a very, like, mix of action and political intrigue.
Mm. Well, as we said at the time and you have said many times since, I don't, like, Ta-Nehisi Coates is a great writer. I don't know if he's a great comic book writer.
Yes. Che, what's your number two?
My number two is The Woman in the Wall, which is a 2023 British thriller mystery, for lack of a better word, that finished airing in the U.S. I think like a couple weeks ago. It started airing in January, so six episodes probably, about a month or so ago it finished airing. It's on Showtime or Paramount Plus, however you want to define it. Those two things are conjoined at this point. I don't know. It's unclear what's what. What isn't? Yeah, whatever.
And it might be getting sold soon anyway. Yeah, so who fucking knows? Well, that'll be in about a couple months.
But I found this show. So this is written and created by Joe Murtaugh, who is pretty fresh face. He has a couple writing credits under his belt, including the Calm with Horses from 2019, a few episodes of Gangs of London, a show we both love, and then last year's The Kitchen, which was quite bad. But The Woman in the Wall, written by him and then directed by Harry Whitliff and Rashan Suri, quite different than The Kitchen, quite good. Stars Ruth Wilson and Darren McCormick, who I've gotten really, really into recently. One of my favorite actors coming out of Ireland in recent years. Has this, like, great physical presence. He's gigantic, it seems, or maybe every actress that he's ever worked across from is, like, really short. But
I remember loving his casting. If he's who I think he was in The Wheel of Time. Never mind. Think about somebody completely different.
I don't remember. He is in The Wheel of Time, but I don't remember.
But not as a character I thought he was. I'll be quiet now. I thought I recognized him from that, but he does look very familiar. I just don't know what I've known him from specifically.
He's probably most famous at this point for his role in The Bad Sisters, the first season, and also in Good Luck to You, Leo Grant.
I mean, like, let's also cannot wait for the upcoming banger that will be Twisters.
Yeah. I am genuinely quite excited to see this guy's career pan out because I think he's a really great performer. And Ruth Wilson, who I've loved for quite a while, since her appearance on Luther, what I guess is probably like almost 10 years ago now, which is insane to say. She's also a great performer. This is basically, I think calling it a mystery is a bit of a lie because there is a mystery at the heart of it, but that's not the focus of it. It's really this story about this deep-seated scar on Irish history, which I had no idea about. These things called Magdalene laundries, which were essentially like I mean, the Cliff Notes version of it is like they were basically Catholic sponsored child abuse centers where
children were
stolen from their mothers and sold off or adopted to other people or literally just like left to starve and die in these churches all over Ireland. And I'm sure all over other Catholic countries that the church has their grubby little fingers in. But Ruth Wilson plays Lorna Brady, who is a mother who was a child herself in the laundry and had a baby that was taken away from her. And she's become like fixated on trying to find this child and is haunted by these traumatic memories of her time in the laundry. And I don't want to spoil too much about the show, but it's basically like it is having visions and sleep and like insomnia and all these things that makes it unclear whether or not she's done a lot of things that she's afraid that she has done, including maybe having killed some people. And on the other end, McCormick is playing Detective Coleman Akande, who is a child who was adopted from a Magdalene laundry and is trying to find his mother, whoever she may be, and is like, because of the nature of these places, there's like not a paper trail or anything. And it brings these two highly unlikely people together in this joint pursuit. And what comes out of it is like six episodes of just like really, one, incredibly active television, which is of course the UK special, just like from top to bottom, excellent actors all across the cast. And also really, I think really well written characters that both feel like really human and flawed in a way that's not off-putting. I find that a lot of these shows about traumatized women and traumatized men, the characters are like have become so unlikable in their PTSD, for lack of a better word, that they're sort of unbelievable. And Ruth Wilson's playing this character who has really alienated everybody in her life out of this single pursuit of this obviously understandable desire to find her daughter, and you see what sort of trauma that's caused and how she can't really connect with anybody, and then finally finds this person who can understand her in a way that really nobody else can, and the joy and relief and also sorrow that brings both of them. I think the show is really beautifully made, and obviously, like I said, Wilson and McCormick, incredible actors. Six episodes quick in and out. If you have Paramount Plus or Showtime, I recommend checking it out. And like I said, it is a bit of a mystery. There's like a mystery element there. The show opens with the murder of a priest, and it's the inciting incident that brings Detective Akande to the small town where this laundry is located, and where Lorna Brady, Ruth Wilson's character, is this murder of the priest. But like, I'll admit, at least personally, that's not the part of the show that I find really all that interesting. And I don't think the show in itself, based on where it goes and the stories it's trying to tell and like how it dives into this history of this of the church that I was myself unaware of, but I'm sure is like quite public knowledge among people who are in the Catholic Church.
Church is bad.
Yeah. Well, I actually think that is a big part of the show that's really interesting, is because, of course, the town, there's a number of these women. Lorna Brady is the main character, but a number of women who are throughout the course of the show trying to get the government basically just to recognize this particular church as a laundry, which is the classification of like these places that this was happening to these women and these babies. And it's a real fight to even get the Irish government to just say this place is a, like, they're not even really asking for anything except for recognition that this horrible thing happened to them, and they're being like spat out in the streets and like abused by the people in the town, because they're like, because these people in the town have this connection to the church, and they are lashing out at these women because they think that they are coming for obviously this thing that they hold really dear, the church and Catholicism and religion. And the juxtaposition of those two things in this show, I think, is handled really well, and is really fascinating. I'm myself just fascinated with organized religion generally, as a person who doesn't take any part in it. I find the that element of media is really fascinating to me. I love a good church show, like the Young Pope. One of my favorite shows ever, because it's just so like
what a strange show.
Oh, so weird, so good, so weird though. The Young Pope is not really anything like The Woman in the Wall. I would not say if those are two related recommendations, but both really quite good shows.
So I'm going to talk about Netflix's new show, Three Body Problem, brought to us by the unfortunate creators.
Light on this one.
I did. I fucking did.
It's a wasteland.
Dr. Chung. Mr. Rooney, you made it.
You were right. There is no solution to the three-body problem. No computer can predict the behavior of three bodies indefinitely. The three suns in the sky. Every civilization ends in chaos. There will eventually be a cataclysm from which we cannot recover. Our planet will be ripped in half, or pulled into one of the suns, or expelled into space forever.
So yeah, I was I did cross Picket Line with this one, but I think it was one of those things where sometimes it's like I really want to watch some hard sci-fi, and that gets me invested. And I was like curious about this one. I had a friend who was very into the books, and she mentioned that she was excited for the TV show. And I was like, looked it up. I'm like, oh, I don't want to watch this. I don't trust these motherfuckers at all. And she was like, the books are done. I'm like, all right, if the books are done, I'll give it a shot.
It is true. I mean, listen, David Benioff and David Benioff and Weiss really, truly fucked us. They fucked us all, and we should never, never, never let them forget that.
No.
They did give us six, like, excellent seasons of television, and that's really where I was. I have not watched The Body Problem yet. I'm hearing from Corey that it's fun, so I will probably check it out.
That's basically fun.
Where I was when Netflix started trying to shove it down my throat. I was like, well, fuck these guys, but also, if it's like season four Game of Thrones good, I have to watch it. I have no choice.
And it's been so long since I've actually watched Game of Thrones, so I can't even comment on that. I keep meaning to
try to go back and watch it just to see if even the good stuff can hold up to the fact that I know how bad it's going to be. No. I'm 100% sure that seasons one through six is good television. Undeniably good television.
Yes.
I will never take that away from them. It's hard to make good TV, and they did it for 6 years. I just don't know if I could still enjoy it knowing how badly it's going to turn out. I just don't know. I haven't tried it yet. I keep meaning to, and then I just don't do it because I don't want to find out that I'm like, this shit is unwatchable now. Sorry. Three Body Problem.
No. It's fine. I mean, I guess my first thought on Three Body Problem, I thought it was very interesting sci-fi. Mm-hmm. I don't really want to go too much into what the concept is about, but it basically goes around our first contact with aliens, and more about the people who did the contacting, and kind of like what
like
the
rival vibes.
In a sense, I mean, basically the story. I mean, this is like a little bit of spoilers, but I think this is kind of what the first two episodes I feel like are actually like this is what the premise is, and it's basically like what if like in the 80s somebody talked to aliens. And then the story also takes place in the current day, and like how that was like how the effects of the past are currently influencing what's happening now in the story. And for what I thought was the first five episodes, I'm like, I'm interested to see where this is going. I kind of like see this as like a slow payoff, a slow show, and then out of nowhere, it gets fucking batshit insane, and I loved it. And I think like when I first started, I'm like, this is like a good show. I mean, like, I'm enjoying with like the sci-fi-ness of it. I think the melodrama of it was a bit strange. I was very concerned. And I don't have a problem with her really as an actress, but I don't have much of an opinion of her as an actress. But when I think it's like really You don't want to, it's, I think when you cast scientists, we actually have to start casting people who seem like scientists. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't, I think it's like, we don't, and I think they really push Isaac Gonzalez as being like the main character of the show, where she's not actually the main character of the show, which I was like, oh, like I was worried because she's not very good in this, I don't think.
We were talking a bit before this podcast, trying to figure out. Because I don't have strong opinions one way or the other on Isaac Gonzalez, but I've seen a lot of stuff that she was in, and I was trying to remember if I'd seen her in one thing that I even was like, she's good in, and I don't think so.
I think that's the thing about the first episode or two with this show, where it's like, the first two episodes, where it's like, you don't really know what it's about. Mm-hmm. And so, like, all we're really seeing right now is, like, people just going through some rough shit, and there's a mystery involved. And then things just keep getting weirder from them. And then you just feel like it's just a, it's one of those shows, like, I don't know if I want to go too much into spoilers with. I don't think it's a perfect show. Hell, I think the show has a lot of problems, honestly. But I think in between those problems is a really interesting concept, which I think that's why I kind of want to, I was mentioning a book I wanted to read, because I'm thinking about actually reading this book. I feel like I'm very hit or miss when it comes to translated works. The original author is Chinese, and I think like that's like something it was translated from that.
It's very tough. It's very always tough. Hard to know. We've had this with comic books in the past too, that we talked about this on the podcast, that it's just like, I'm not clear what's going on here versus like is this prose clunky because the author intended it this way, or because the author themselves is not a very good writer, or is the translation clunky? And it's like, I as someone who is a dumb American and only speaks English, will just never be able to know what the original text of these things is really like. And it's just hard to, it's hard. We talked about it before. I think we talked about it in particular with Day Tripper, that the comic we did a long time ago.
Yeah.
Where the book, the narrative is really beautiful. But I just remember thinking the whole time reading it being like, the dialogue is very stilted, and I can't tell if it's a thematic choice because this guy is like in a dream sequence, or because the translation is poor. And it's hard. Yeah. I'll never know.
I've heard the books are good, so I do plan to give it a shot. Mm-hmm. But I guess like, you actually say like Arrival is like an interesting way to look at this, because I think of it as it's sci-fi where they're trying to take a very like, obviously it's a bunch of like bullshit sometimes, but a lot of the times it's like they're trying to like use like sci-fi as a way to like science as a way to like explain and tackle these problems.
Yeah.
It's not going to be a bunch of people like with guns shooting at the other thing. It's a bit of reacts. Listen,
if it's anything like Arrival, which, you know, Arrival is still one of my favorite movies of all
time. It's nowhere near as good as Arrival. I do not think
Benioff and Weiss are capable of filmmaking the same way that Denis Villeneuve is, who's like maybe one of the best living filmmakers right now, period. I wasn't thinking about that, but I just mean like narratively, I have always been really at awed with how smart Arrival is as far as sci-fi goes. So,
and I think it also is like that with The Martian. Like I was thinking about The Martian a lot too, where it's like this guy with a problem and they're using like, they're using science as a way for him to solve the problem.
Of hot scientists. Not a lot of scientists like Matt Damon.
That's what I'm fucking saying. Like, all of these scientists, I'm like, what are we doing here?
It's just, it is really funny because my favorite part of Arrival, a movie that I think is near perfect, is like, they work so hard to make Amy Adams' incredibly attractive movie star look like a normal lady. You're just like, no, I'm sorry.
No, it doesn't make
That's
any sense.
That's not what normal people look like.
And I will, like, he doesn't have as much of a presence in the first couple episodes. But Liam Cunningham, who plays Sir Davos from Game of Thrones, is having the time of his fucking life on this show. And he is chewing up every scene he's in. Mm. And if you're going to watch the show, just watch it for him alone. He is truly, he's one of my favorite TV characters I've seen in a long time.
They dipped into the Game of Thrones.
They dipped into it hard, man.
Jonathan Pryce in this one. Obviously, John Bradley. He's one of the main characters, right?
Yeah. He's one of the, the story kind of takes place between, like, this woman who is going through it and during the Chinese like Cultural Revolution, she's fucking going through it back then, and a group of five like Oxford students of this professor who killed herself, and they all like reunite after that, and it kind of just like the mystery of why she killed herself kind of like spins out and affects these five, and it kind of cascades into the overall effects on the world. I don't want to spoil the show because I think just going into it and kind of getting... I think people should give it a watch. And if you get through episode 5 and you're like, Corey, you're an asshole, that's fine. But I think just get through that halfway point.
Episode 5 is so deep.
I know. It's so deep. Isn't it? You know the lovely thing about
television shows? That is the Netflix experience, though, is be like, hey, it's gonna be a tough hang for like a bit. And then
I don't think it's even like... good. It's not even a tough hang. It's just kind of one of those things where I'm like, this was fine. And then
yeah,
I'm like...
it's a slow start. Yeah.
See, my thing is like, I was working to like The Expanse. Because everyone talks about how good The Expanse is. And I'm like, oh my God, I cannot get through The Expanse.
They're all lying to you. The Expanse does not get better. I'm here to say it on the record. As someone who sat through 2 fucking seasons of that show while I was still on Sci-Fi, I can't... The number of times people were like, yo... The Expanse is such great sci-fi. I was like, you've never fucking seen good sci-fi, have you? You have no idea what's going on. I'm a big time The Expanse hater.
But look, I think like I'm very up on like sci-fi shit, I think, currently. And I think it's like hitting a fun wave recently of like television and movies. And I'm kind of excited to see things keep going. And I don't know. I like a slow built mystery surrounding like shit like this. And I especially love it when like... a group with a problem, like, I mean, that's why I like Nice House on the Lake so much, where it's just a group of friends who are dealing with a very big problem. And I kind of like, I mean, I like those kind of shows, even though it's so, like, it's so unlikely that it'd always be, like, this specific group of people dealing with, like, this cascading... Of course, but I mean, from, like, a story perspective, it is usually a lot of fun.
But I'm with you that I think sci-fi television has gotten to a really interesting point where, at the very least, people are trying a lot of really cool stuff. Like, for example, a show that I think is maybe so far not been super like necessarily successful, but is at least trying something really interesting is the Constellation on Apple TV, which like I said, I'm not loving, but it's different in a way that is,
You asked me about that.
Yeah. Cause I think it's up your alley in that it's like a sci-fi mystery show.
That's my shit.
And I will not spoil anything about Constellation. I'm not pitching here today either, but it's just like, I think it's trying really fascinating stuff, the same way that like Beacon 23 was, I think, trying some really interesting stuff and maybe not succeeding. But I'd rather people try things than make the same garbage over and over again. Like, for example, speaking of Apple TV shows, I don't understand who the fuck asked for Manhunt. I don't know why anybody was like, we need 8 hours of a show about John Wilkes Booth. I don't know who wanted it. It's not good. Is not doing it for me, but
Che, how dare you disrespect my love of John Wilkes Booth?
I listen. If you're a big John Wilkes Booth head, I apologize. Maybe you're the one that was asking for it, but I just think it's a waste of Anthony Boyle, who was in concurrent Apple TV shows at the same time. So I don't know what they, and also was in Tetris, and that they maybe he's got like Apple stock or something. And I think he's really good, but he's such a waste in Manhunt. I mean, man, that show boring as fuck. But, old white men in your 40s. I apologize. I know super into that sort of stuff. But
I was watching the show, though. It's like one of those things where I'm like, it's like walking the line. It's like Che's razor. I'm like, either he's going to hate or like the show. Not love it, but I'm like, you're either going to hate this show or like the show. And so it's hard for me to recommend it to you specifically.
Which, Three Body Problem?
Yes. Because I don't know if you're going to like, because it's more to you, I'm like, this is so annoying. I
have less tolerance for sci-fi and genre TV and movies in general than I think a lot of people do. I am like I know a lot of people in my life who I really respect their opinion on a lot of stuff who are like, Lord of the Rings was fun. Rings of Power, that is specifically. And I was like, so you just like all fantasy?
I thought you were about to say some wild shit. I'm like,
No. The original Lord of the Rings trilogy.
I was a little bit shocked for about 3 seconds. I'm like, Che, we might have to talk about this.
I'm not insane. This is my point. I love fantasy and sci-fi and genre fiction generally in all mediums when it's really, really good. I mean, for example, you can see on my wall, I have fucking Blade Runner 2049 and Devs sitting next to each other. Like, I love sci-fi when it's really good. I don't tolerate or have a lot of interest in like C+ sci-fi and fantasy, where I think people who are fans of sci-fi and fantasy will be like, as long as it's not bad, I'll enjoy it.
I think it's like a weird thing with my brain where like, if the concept is cool, I am into the concept. Yeah. But if you fuck up, like, whenever they want to do the human story, it just kind of annoys me. You know what? I like The Rival so much because The Rival was just like focusing on the problem and they got some human shit in there, but it's like the problem is the problem.
Yeah, yeah.
And what was killing me for all mankind was, like, the space stuff was really cool, and I liked that shit, but, like, all of the back home Houston shit was so...
people cheating on their wives.
And I'm like, I don't give a fuck about this, man.
It's
like,
a lot of people just cheating on their wives.
I want to, like, I give a shit about the implications of Russia getting on the moon. I think at least with Rebody Problem, I was like, oh my God, we're dealing with so much. I'm like, oh shit, actually, you know, hold on, shit actually happened. I was like, because I felt like that thing with, like, for all my kind of shit just wasn't happening.
Yeah, yeah.
But through Rebody Problem, like, things actually start happening. And that's why I like Silo, because Silo was like, there's a problem, and the problem is happening, and we're focusing on this problem.
I'm about to Severance, put myself in a fucking coma and wait for Severance Season 2 or Silo to drop so I can stop this week.
Exactly. And, like, Severance, like, of, like, the personal problems has so much to do with actually what's happening in the story. All of it feels intentional and important. It makes sense, and it's good. And I think, at least to me, besides one character's, like, plot and three body problems, they all have a sense of payoff.
Okay. Good.
But I was worried that they weren't. Because sometimes I'm like, what are we doing here? And then I'm like, okay, this is what we were doing here. Then that's, I don't know. The book, it seemed like the author of the book is very smart, and she has a very good understanding of stories and how to tie it all together. I don't know, like, you know, so I'm more, I think in a way, that's why I left the series being like, I'm interested to read the books, because I'm interested to see where the story's going. Mm-hmm. But I recommend the show. I recommend people check out the show. I think it's a wild ride. If you have nothing else going on, to watch it. Che, what's your last thing, though?
Yes. So, the appeal of this episode, in a lot of ways, to me, was, it'd be like a quick hitter for us, which is rare. We normally do really long episodes, and I was like, this will be perfect. It'll be 5 minutes each. We'll get out in 50 minutes. We're at the 2-hour mark on the record. So that's us in a nutshell. So I'm going to be quick about this movie. My final pitch...
Don't shame me.
My final pitch is the film Scrapper from last year.
Hi. Sorry, that's my bike. Hi there. We were just making sure that all of these bikes were road safety. And we were just walking by. Oh, yours isn't, by the way. We were just walking by and we just... Yeah, we thought it looked a bit... You know?
Yeah. God, I should probably go get that serviced or something.
Yeah, yeah, full service. You can never be too careful. Yeah, the bearing's, like, completely gone in the back wheel. Do you want me to be honest?
Yeah, fire away.
Or just a little bit of lies, or...
I have talked about it on this podcast before, but I am, and I've done it before, and I know a lot of you are really excited. The four of you that read my truly insane manuscript that was the 2020 film March Madness bracket, I am doing it again, and I'm in the middle of writing. So, the boys are playing basketball, the women are playing basketball, the other boys are wrestling. It's happening. We're in the middle of the tournaments, and I'm writing, and I'm gonna get it out. But catching up on a few movies, and one of the ones I caught up on recently was Charlotte Reagan's film from last year, Scrapper, starring Harris Dickinson and Lola Campbell. And I was really taken with this movie. I think it's really quite fun, really, really beautiful. I'm a big fan of Harris Dickinson, have been for a while. I think he's a really talented performer, obviously, for those of you probably most famous for Triangles of Sadness, unless you are one of the 17 people who aren't diehard WWE fans who saw The Iron Claw. He was also in that. I think he's just really good in everything I've seen him in, and he's really good in this. And alongside him is, I think, the most impressive thing in all of filmmaking is finding a good child actor. It's nearly fucking impossible. Nearly. We've done it like a couple dozen times ever in film. And Lola Campbell is just a great example of it. She's really walking the line between... So the character... Basically, the plot of this movie is a young girl, I think probably supposed to be around like...
12 says 12 years old.
Okay, she's 12 years old. Okay, so she is left alone after her mother passes away from an illness. I don't remember if it's ever specifically said what it is, but either way, it's a terminal illness that leaves her a bit, like left alone. And when we first meet her in the film, she's basically taking care of herself. And by taking care of herself, she's basically like stealing bikes to and selling them to criminals to fund her life. And we see her,
as we all do.
Exactly. Like, I see her going down to the shop and like buying laundry detergent and feeding herself and hanging out with her friend. And seems like she is as well adjusted as a abandoned 12-year-old can be. And then her life gets this life that she sort of meticulously crafted gets thrown into disarray when her estranged father comes back, who's played by Harris Dickinson. And Campbell really expertly walks the line between being like a believable kid. Like, it never seen. I find precocious children in movies really annoying because it's like, no kid's ever been like this. Like, no kid is like this smart or like fucking Young Sheldon, which a show I've never seen. But I assume that kid's really fucking irritating. But she,
you would hate Ghostbusters.
She seems like a believable child, like a 12-year-old, but also believably independent, and manages to take these two obviously like diametrically opposed ideas and executes them well, and is also quite funny. And a good performer and has good chemistry with Harris Dickinson. Like, they have this beautiful moment at the end where they share this father-daughter moment that the movie's been really leading up to. And it doesn't work if Campbell isn't a really excellent performer. I thought this movie is really, really fun, really, really touching. Charlotte Regan, I don't know any of her stuff. This is my first film of hers. I'll be definitely checking her out. I think she's done a couple of feature length films before, but if this is her first feature length film, I'm excited to see where she goes from here. This is kind of one of those movies that's for everybody. I think I'd call it a comedy. It's like a dark comedy. And really, it is a good payoff. And like I said, great performances, well acted. It's some interesting, like, I find that comedies are usually shot pretty flat. It's usually just some guy sticks a camera in front of some people. Because a lot of modern comedies
are
real improv heavy. They just sort of plop the camera in a scene and try to capture as much funny stuff as they can, which can make incredible stuff. Like, I love Anchorman. Don't get me wrong. But it's impossible to shoot Anchorman in an interesting way because you can't block out scenes if you're just going to let Will Ferrell take the reins and run. I think Scrapper is shot really in an interesting way at some point. So it's a really well-made film as well. Another one that I believe is on Showtime, because I think this is an A24 film, and for the moment at least, all those are... No, it's a BFI film. But I think is available on Showtime to check out. I didn't really intend to do a bunch of Paramount recommendations today. It was not... this all happened by accident, but yeah, you can go check that out. If you're looking for a Scrapper from 2023, which you will hear more about in my coming piece, which I guarantee you is coming, the 2023 film March Madness bracket, a lot of really fun movies in there, including Scrapper. So I don't know, Corey, should we just end this? Is there anything else to say?
I think we should just end it, friend.
Let's end it. Just a reminder before we close out, if you've made it this far, thank you very much. Don't forget to follow us at Next Time on Pod all over the place. If you're over there on YouTube currently, drop us a like, drop us a subscribe. It helps us out.
Please do.
Stuff. You can find all this stuff, including that coming piece, including my rundown of the Oscars, which is not necessarily out of date. There's just talk about movies from last year over on nexttimeon.net. That's where all of our archived writing, all of our podcasts, all that good stuff is. And a final reminder that our next episode is going to be Damn Them All by Simon Spurrier. So if you're reading along, don't forget to pick that up. Anything else for the people, Corey?
Nothing else for me.
All right. I've been Che.
I've been Corey.
We'll see you guys next time.
Bye.
Sweet Christmas.